My name is Christine Fox, and I'm an assistant director here at Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory. And it is such a pleasure to have all of you with us today. We had a terrific start this morning, and I'm really happy that you're with us for our panel, our first panel on machines with us. And I would venture to say that machines are indeed with us today. They are with us in pretty much every way. We are living inside of a technology explosion. And with that explosion, as we've already started talking, comes opportunities and risks. We are clearly benefiting from technology that makes our lives more convenient, more efficient. We have greater access to information than we've ever had before. We're more effective on the battlefield. And we're living longer with a much better quality of life. And new technologies and machines are being introduced every day. And just around the corner, we'll have driverless cars and even housebots that are going to help us be partners in the household to take care of all those chores that none of us love to do in everyday life, which I certainly will look forward to signing up for. But with that, there are also some risks, and we've also already started talking about those risks. What happens when machines get too smart, smarter than us? What happens when they realize that they're smarter than us? Or what about fusion, enhanced humans, brain control interface? What happens when people who mean to do harm with those technologies get access to it and use it? Should we listen to people like Stephen Hawking, who suggests that artificial intelligence may hold the potential existential threat to the future of mankind? Well, I don't know the answer to these questions, but I'm very privileged today to say that we have a panel who has thought deeply about these issues and is going to help us explore these issues and others this morning and begin a conversation that will continue into the afternoon on human-machine partnering and human-machine fusion. Today we have with us, we have David Hanson. David is going to talk with us about his breakthroughs in robotics. He's going to talk about the world that he foresees where robots have lifelike human features and human characteristics that will open up new and exciting doors for our future. We have Geoff Ling, a friend of APL, who's going to talk about the possibilities of brain-computer interface and that future of fusion. Human brains in direct control of machines, whether integrated into the body or outside of it. Geoff is going to take us to this future world where this type of fusion changes pretty much everything. Next, we are so fortunate to have the Honorable Bob Work, our Deputy Secretary of Defense and the visionary behind the third offset strategy. Bob will tell us how these exploding technologies might indeed change the future of warfare and how these changes will be game-changing. Finally, we have Anders Sandberg. Anders is going to bring us a thoughtful perspective on these envisioned futures, and he's going to ask us some questions about whether these future worlds are worlds we will want, or whether they will pose threats in ways that we have not yet imagined. After we hear from our panelists, we will invite you to join in the conversation and debate about these issues in the same way we did this morning through mics and Slido. So with that, I'd like to open it up with David Hanson, who's going to talk about Hanson Robotics. David, over to you.
Thank you so much. I'm very excited to be here today. I'm in from Hong Kong, where I am the CEO of Hanson Robotics. We develop robots with a very lifelike exterior. We say we bring robots to life, and I'll explain to you that I mean not just in the sense of bringing them into useful applications, I do mean that, but we are looking to bring robots to life literally as artificial organisms and kind of physically embodied artificial life. So let me show you a few animations of some robots that I developed in graduate school. I got my PhD in many disciplines. It was a program at the University of Texas at Dallas that had computer science, arts and humanities. I did material science and cognitive science and artificial intelligence. Developed this Albert Einstein, which mounted on the Hubo robot from KAIST that went on to win the DARPA Robotics Challenge. Also developed some prototypes for consumer products, and I'm excited to tell you today about how we have now successfully scaled the manufacturing and design of these consumer products, and we're bringing them to market this year. So this fits into the context of science fiction, as we've heard today. Machines that used to be the stuff of dreams has now become a little more real. Now, we know that these are in our factories, and they're driving our cars around the streets of the United States today, and they're getting more effective and smarter. And they're cleaning our houses to some extent. The trends are still ongoing. What's interesting to me is how robots, intuitively, we think of them as life forms. And occasionally, we give them the form of life. In particular, we have a natural affinity to the human-like form. We are evolved for responding to human-like form, and all of our tools and our work environments are built around the human-like form. But what's interesting is that most robots don't have natural facial expressions or the form of a social being. Now, if you look at another kind of computer-generated agent, a computer animation for films and video games, you see very natural forms, and people respond intensively to these kinds of forms. So these are generating billions of dollars of revenue in movies and interactive character-based games, story games. Now you see also in artificial intelligence an increasing trend towards lifelike agents, and a demand for these agents like Siri and Cortana and Alexa to be more emotionally responsive, to be more nuanced in ways that are human-like. Well, so where is this trend in robotics? You generally don't see a lot of robots with lifelike forms. What I have tried to do with my team at Hanson Robotics is, and if you'll hit the volume, please, tried to solve these in a variety of forms, cartoon-like characters, multiple ethnicities, very realistic faces. So I've developed a wide array of different technologies for achieving this, which I'll tell you about in a few minutes. So we've won a few awards in this. We've now produced a product that we call the Professor Einstein, which is coming to market in a month and a half at $299, shipping to customers. It's already shipped to our test customers, and we've gotten very positive responses. We've also received an investment from Disney, and we're making Disney character robots. We're making human-sized robots. So Professor Einstein makes these very natural-looking facial expressions, which allow him to teach science in a really natural way. So teach a science to kids, and also programming and robotics. So you can actually learn neural nets from Professor Einstein and program your own neural nets. Small robots are a big business, multi-billion dollar business, and that's why we're targeting small robots. We're also putting out open platforms for artificial intelligence development. We are developing human-sized robots as a platform for artificial intelligence as well, and as a kind of media property. So our robot Sophia has received over a billion views, natural expressions, and we've scaled the manufacturing. We're now making dozens of Sophia robots, which are going out in rental markets. So she has had several viral hits. She's been on the cover of Elle magazine. She's been on The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon. We're giving her the walking body capabilities that you saw with the Professor Einstein. But now that the Hubo robot has won the DARPA Robotics Challenge, we can say that it is among the most physically capable robots in the world. So we're giving Sophia and Einstein a body upgrade this year. This builds on a lot of research that we've done, including building cognitive models of infants with the Machine Perception Lab at the Institute for Neural Computation at University of California at San Diego. This is Diego-san, built for that lab. We also did some work with the AFRL and Centers for Disease Control. We did a lot of additional robots from a wide variety of research. The key that we're looking at is this artificial intelligence. We have this brain architecture that allows us to pursue artificial general intelligence. We think artificial life is the key to making artificial general intelligence that shows emergence, creativity, and imagination. So we're looking at these kind of mathematics, like the edge of chaos transition, in order to bring in artificial life into our AGI, whole organism simulation. Why is this relevant? Well, because with these kinds of accelerating trends, we're starting to see increasing performance the more we integrate between the biosciences and robotics and intelligence systems. So you see a lot of robots with more lifelike behaviors. How can we, if we make them intelligent, make them caring and safe? We think that this artificial organism approach, artificial life, will allow us to start considering these issues of fundamental physics and informatics of benevolent superintelligent machines. Maybe they will be a road to paradise, or maybe these machines could spiral out of control. I think that we need to consider these things. What I propose is that we think of the issues now of benevolent superintelligence, and in particular, we think of the kind of pattern dynamics that lead to maximum gain for the largest number of people. So we need artificial general intelligence, I argue, in order to solve the complex problems of our times. So in other words, things will not turn out well for us if we don't solve these problems and start tackling them now. I propose that we pull together. We need a global initiative to create benevolent superintelligence. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Next, we'll hear from Geoff Ling. It's perfect. Thank you.
So I really enjoyed the keynote speeches today, and I particularly Professor Hanson's very erudite description of where robots are and this idea of benevolence. But I think the picture here is actually a lot broader than that. What does it mean to evolve? Fundamentally, what does it mean to evolve? So we know that the dinosaurs lived for millions upon millions of years and ultimately died out, but there was an evolutionary process there, gave way to the mammals, and on it goes. Humans have been on Earth for, you know, at least Homo sapiens, for a couple of 100,000 years, not a very long time. But what does it mean to evolve? What is the next phase of life on Earth? Do we really believe that we've achieved the pinnacle of what's going to be life on Earth? We like to think so, but is that in fact true? And how long will it take to evolve to the next level? And I would argue that we are really at the inflection point, as Dr. Semmel said, of really a remarkable future. And this remarkable future is such that it's not going to be necessarily Darwinianism, but it's going to be one that can almost be engineered. So you heard about the CRISPR Cas9 technology, phenomenal technology, but it's the first element of it. There's already more things coming online. We all know that. Once the delivery system is optimized to deliver those things that CRISPR-Cas can offer, which is the next big step, and there are people already working on that, now we're going to see an explosion of engineered biological systems. This is good, this is bad, maybe, but really comes back to this question of evolution. I don't think that it's rational to think that mankind will sit there and abdicate everything to an in silico platform. I just don't. Humans are tool users. That's what we are. Our brains are inside this body. This body has certain tools. They're called hands, they're called feet. We have sensors, they're called eyes, they're called ears, they're called Pacini and Meissner corpuscles on the end of your fingertips. But the confines of this body or what limit the capabilities of what our brain can actually do. And if you took our brains and you moved it into a different vesicle, what could you do? What would you do? Is there EM in this room? Is there IR in this room? Is there UV in this room? Of course there is. You do not see them. You do not perceive them, but it doesn't mean they're not here. And you can imagine if you had sensors that allowed you the capability of seeing in that widened spectra or hear in a widened spectra and was able to dump that data directly into your biological brain. Could you use it? Of course you could use it. Would you use it? Of course you would use it. What would art, what would music be like at that point? So this is all about evolution. Since we are already brains inside of a machine, a biological machine, but it's still a machine nonetheless. It's got two hands, two legs. What could you do with a third arm? What would you do with four legs? Man wanted to move faster than he invented a car. Man wanted to fly, invented an airplane. Man wanted to go to the moon, invented a rocket. All those things were just extensions of ourselves. Think about when you drive a car now. You do not do it the same way you did when you were 16 years old and your dad was screaming at you, right? You turn. You know, you go fast. You slow down, you go slow down, and the like. You've adopted the machine that is the car. So why in heaven's name would you abdicate yourself to an inanimate object next to you? You would be part of it, and it will become part of you. There's no question about it. And you will evolve with it, and it will evolve with you. If we can do CRISPR-Cas9, and you can wire me into one of David's robots, why would I not use CRISPR-Cas9 to increase the capacity of my brain? Why would I not increase my cortical density? Why would I not increase my cerebral blood flow? Why would I not increase the ability of me to create more dendritic spining? We all thought that the Watson computer was only a couple of order of magnitudes less than the human brain. Well, guess what? We're wrong. We just have new data came out just a couple of weeks ago in Nature showing that the density of dendritic spining, that's the back end of a neuron, not the front end, is 20 to 50 times more than we actually thought before. We have absolute, irrefutable proof of it. So if you had CRISPR-Cas9 technology or better, and you were afraid a machine was going to catch up to you, boost me up. Make my brain bigger. Make my brain faster. Make my brain more efficient. Why not? Who would not do that? Think about what you do for your kids. You want your kids to go to Princeton and Harvard. Actually, I prefer them to go to Johns Hopkins, personally, President Daniels. I get the tuition benefit. So, but the reality is, because I am a professor, I work for President Daniels, so full disclosure. But the reality is that what don't you do for your child now? What don't you do for your child now? What will your child do for the next one, for their children, your grandchildren? And on it goes. We think we're confined too much in our thinking. So when I was at DARPA, I challenged my program managers to say, don't tell me what's possible, don't tell me what's probable. Tell me what you aspire to. What is your aspirational goal? I remember one time when I was with a group of Rangers, and they said, you know, sir, we would like a better stretcher. That's what we really, really want, a better stretcher. And I said, why in heaven's name do you even want a stretcher? Why don't you have something you can inject into a wound that will heal that fracture to the point where it can be bare weight and the dude can walk out? Because if you have a stretcher, you just took four combat soldiers off the line to carry the fifth one. So we now have five casualties, essentially. Where if you did this, the guy walks out, he's still a shooter, and you still have four shooters. What do you aspire to? So the conversation shouldn't be how do we, you know, fend off these machines, and you know, how do we sit there and make a benevolent machine? Forget that. What do you envision mankind should be in the next 100 years? What do we aspire to? We aspire to a man or a woman who doesn't get cancer, who doesn't have myocardial disease, who doesn't have autism and mental health problems, who doesn't get dementia. I think about all my friends at Hopkins now. Will they get cancer under control? Oh, by golly, they will. Will they get sudden coronary myocardial disease under control? They already have. When I went to med school, people were dying of heart attacks. That's not what they die of today. Sure, they die, some of them do, but not like they were. But if you live to 80 or 90 and you have Alzheimer's disease, who the hell cares? Right? I mean, it's great to live to 90, but if you're in a wheelchair wearing a diaper smelling like day-old urine, that's not really a good future for you. So it comes back to, again, what are we aspiring to? What do we expect man to be? We can do these things. I believe there's going to be a link between man and machine. Why would you abdicate yourself to have this thing do everything for you? That is not the human experience. Instead, link yourself to it. Give yourself a D drive. Give yourself faster computational ability. And if you're so afraid this machine's gonna take over for you, boost your brain. No problem. No problem. Increased dendritic density. If I already know that we're 50 times more than we thought that we were a little while ago, and you ask us, why is that? I don't know the answer to that myself personally, but I actually challenged my friends in the neuroscience world why that is. Right? Why is that? But if you have the capability of manipulating the biology, and you have the capability of manipulating the in silico, the two together will always be better than one by itself. So now the discussion shouldn't be about what if bad, what if good. It should be about what do we aspire to? What do we think the next evolutionary phase of mankind should be? Because that's what we should build towards. If you just turn scientists and technologists loose and say make stuff, they're going to make stuff. But really what you want to do is you're not about building tech, you're about building capability. This was what Arthur Brubaker, our former DARPA director, used to beat into us. And I absolutely agree with her. You're building capability. But what is that capability? What is your dream? That's what we should building towards. That's where the discussion should be. The ethics will follow. If you know where you're going, the ethics will follow. And the ethics shouldn't be just Judeo-Christian, European. Because as we go around the world, when I served in Afghanistan, when I served in Iraq, I met people who had different codes of what they thought was right and wrong. And it's fine, because it worked for them. I totally get it. Who are we to say to them? But at the same time is, we still all come back to the same fundamental thing. What should man become? What should man evolve to? If we, really, in this room, if we all believe that we're the pinnacle of it all, that's pretty sad. Right? Because I am short and ugly. I am not handsome like him, and I'm not tall like him. So honestly, if I was going to build a better me, I would be handsome like him and tall like him. But that's not going to happen. But that's my aspirational goal. So I say to us again in this whole room, is this conversation about AI and about better robots and about better machines. Let's fall back to what we fundamentally are. We're a brain inside of a biological machine. We can be a brain inside of a machine of our own design. But now, instead of letting Darwinism happen, Brownian motion happen to our future, why don't we just say to ourselves collectively, this is what we aspire to be. If we want to be a better benevolent being, if we want to be a better social being, if we want to be a more humane being that lives longer, that is acts smarter, then let's build towards that future. Because those tools are in our hands right now. They really are. It's a really remarkable time in history, is it not? And of course, it's lovely to be working with APL, who's leading the revolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Geoff. Inspiring as always. And now we really are very, very fortunate to have the Deputy Secretary of Defense with us today, who has to leave promptly from our panel to go to an important meeting in the White House, so we won't keep you any longer, and I'll turn it over to you.
I don't know what to say after Geoff. I would just like to state for the record that I'm the handsome one. Look, brothers and sisters, my name is Bob Work, and I have sinned. We are on the cusp of a new era in warfare, in which human machines collaborate and partner, and it will change the character of war. But I am starting to believe very, very deeply that it is also going to change the nature of war. And that is my sin. There is no greater sin in the profession of war than to say that what is happening before our eyes will change the nature and not the character of war. Character is just the way technology forms, impacts operations. But the nature, a violent collision of wills with uncertainty, friction, fear, that is immutable in the faith of a warrior. But I believe that we have to start to question that very faith. And that is why I came to the temple of APL, where I'm surrounded by fellow sinners. And also, my boss, the warrior monk, happens to be out of the country, so I won't get killed today for saying what I'm saying. But AI, autonomy, intelligent machines, and robotics will definitely change the character of war, and I'll come back to why I think it might change the nature of war. Now, this is a natural progression for me. For the last two decades, I've been thinking about how the shift from unguided weapons warfare to guided weapons warfare has changed the character of war. Now, unguided weapons warfare, all the way up from millennial, all the way to World War II, everything that you threw, you shot, you dropped, you launched, almost everything missed the targets. Unguided weapons warfare therefore had an inherent bias towards mass. You had to assemble 1,000 B-17s over Schweinfurt to assure a single statistical target hit of the Schweinfurt ball bearing factory. If you lived near Schweinfurt, it was very, very bad. But you would take care of that problem. It was in maneuver. You would assemble your maneuver force and try to get a localized advantage so your fires would have a statistical effect on the enemy. You would achieve fire superiority. You would close with and destroy the enemy and move on. Up until World War II, two things presented themselves. One was atomic warfare, close enough for government work. You didn't have to worry about missing the target because the destructive effect of the nuclear weapon or atomic weapon was so vast that it would probably take out the target anyway. But in World War II, guided munitions came along. And what guided munitions had was accuracy independent of range. And in combat, you always want to outstick your opponent. You want to be able to shoot at them before they can shoot at you. Doesn't matter if it's naval warfare, air warfare, ground warfare, submarine warfare. If you can take the first shot in guided munitions warfare, you are going to be in a pretty good place. Now, that impacted tactical operations all the time. I mean, the tactical operators knew this right away. And generally, the first ones that moved to guided munitions were those that had to shoot at a target that moved freely in three dimensions. But in 1973 to 1975, some people said, well, what happens when we go to the operational level of war and we assemble a theater-level battle network that can see through the entire battle space and you can fire guided munitions at will in large densities? And we started to think about, okay, what does 24-hour all-weather guided munitions warfare do? And I would say it started an era of human-machine interaction and combat segregation. The GUI, the graphical user interface, allowed humans to interact with computers. And you saw things like chat rooms, and you saw things like looking through large amount of data. But it was more of an interaction. And combat segregation, we would let unmanned systems do what was called the dull, dirty, and dangerous. Dull, just something like standing watch. Never gets tired, never worries about the rain, just watches. Dangerous, put unmanned systems where humans aren't. And dirty, put unmanned systems into chemical areas or radiological areas. So I would say that that large area of human-machine interaction and combat segregation is now changing. But even that changed the very idea of mass and changed the very idea of tempo at the operational level of war. And we've had a good long run of it. And so what's happening is we're thinking about, oh, now the other guys have battle networks as good as ours. They can throw guided munitions as far, as accurately, and as densely as we can, and we got to do something about that. So we have to start thinking about that. And the Defense Science Board said, this is a very simple problem. You must embrace artificial intelligence and autonomy, and you must infuse it throughout your force. And if you do that, and you do it better than our adversaries, you will maintain a competitive advantage over time. Now, the question early on, autonomy. The DSB defined autonomy in a very simple way. Delegating the authority to an entity authorized to take actions within specific boundaries. When you talk with someone, you say, well, that's not an autonomous weapon because it didn't make its own decision. We call it fire and forget. Rather than keeping your radar on an airplane, which draws you inevitably closer and closer and closer to their shot, you want to take your shot and turn away. And the missile does everything on its own, fully autonomously, within specified boundaries. Back to what Stav was saying, we are not going to decide weapons that decide what target to hit. We're going to say, when we launch you, you can hit one of these five targets. And oh, by the way, here's the priority that we want you to service them at. And if you don't find the fifth target, you don't get to decide that you're going to go kill something else. You will either dive into the ocean or self-destruct. That is autonomy as it exists now. You can envision a world with general intelligence where a weapon might make those decisions, but we are certain that we do not want to pursue that at this time. And that was what the third offset was all about. The third offset said, we're going to do better in learning machines. We're going to do better in human-machine collaboration, which is using machines to allow humans to make better and more timely and more relevant decisions. We're going to do assisted, not enhanced combat operations. Our adversaries might go to enhanced, but we are not thinking of it at this time yet, because it's a little too scary, quite frankly. Human-machine combat teaming and autonomous networked-enabled weapons. Now, within those five areas, we're trying to do a lot of things. This is an inevitable competition. AI and autonomy is changing our society, and whenever society changes, like in the telegraph and railroad and rifle revolution, it will inevitably change the way you fight wars. Time is decisive now. First shot is often determinative on the outcome. So the faster you can make your decisions to achieve the effects you want, you're going to have an advantage. Mass, once again, matters. In the guided weapons munitions regime, you didn't really have to mass, you just had to mass effects. Well, now when the bad guy has it, you have to think about mass again. But here's the thing. All three of two of our big adversaries all have an inducement to go after unmanned systems. For the Russians, they have a terrible demographic problem. In 2030, they're not going to have enough people to populate their army. So they have a goal to have 30% of their forces robotic. So they want robots to take care of their demographic problem. The United States values human life in our volunteer force, above all things. We have an inducement to go after guided munitions to save those lives. The Chinese, every single son and daughter that serves in the Chinese military is what we would call a sole surviving child. You lose a battalion of Chinese infantrymen, and there are 500 families whose progeny are wiped out. They have an incentive to go after unmanned systems, too. So we're going to go through this period where AI, and Garry Kasparov said, look, AI starts where it's laughably weak, then it becomes interesting but feeble, then it becomes artificial but useful, and then it becomes transcendent and superior to humans. Surprise is going to be endemic because a lot of the advances that the other people are doing in their weapon systems, we won't see until we fight them. And if they have artificial intelligence in them that is better than ours, that's going to be a bad day. So let me come back to the nature of war. Look, the nature of war is all about a collision of will, fear, uncertainty, and chance. You have to ask yourself, how does fear play out in a world in which a lot of the action is taking place between unmanned systems? Uncertainty is going to be different now. Clausewitz had a term called coup d'œil, which is the inner eye. It really was, back then, a person who could sit on a horse, surveil the terrain, and instinctively and instantly know how to array their forces to have a decisive advantage on the battlefield. Learning machines are going to give more and more commanders coup d'œil, especially in the dialectic method. Right now, I'll tell you right now, there are not that many captains who are going to tell a four-star COCOM, that idea sucks. They just aren't going to do it. But I guarantee you a machine and a dialectical method, when you're developing your campaign, the machine will say, you are an idiot. There's a 99% probability you will get your ass handed to you. Now, how do you select commanders? Are you going to select commanders who just listen to the machines? I hope not. You want to have commanders who have free will and can take the input of machines and decide what needs to be happened on the battlefield. Look, we're scared about this. I'd also like to say, hey, we talked about the humans. Anybody here, I think most of the people know about the marine mammal program, where we take really smart sea lions and dolphins, and they go out, and they're really good about finding swimmers, and they're really good about finding mines. The best hunters in the world in a jungle environment is a chimpanzee community. If I can control them against other people's special operators, I am going to win the Planet of the Apes. So let's not just think about this in terms of people. And I agree with Stav 100%. This is two sides of the same coin. We are on the verge of machines that have lifelike qualities, and we are on the verge of humans that can be digitally enhanced. Two sides of the same coin. So believe me, sinners, or I don't know if you're sinners, but I know I am. This is a time of deep reflection. What are the ethical, moral things that we have to do? This is a great start, and I really want to applaud John Hopkins for setting this up. We need to have a lot more of these, and whenever they're talking about science fiction and movies, I'll be there. So, danger, Will Robbins. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Awesome comments. Thank you. So now over to Anders.
Wow. This is a rare treat for me. I get to be the conservative, cautious guy on the panel. This almost never happens because I'm the wild guy talking about human enhancement and AI and the potential. And now I get to be the one urging a bit of caution and maybe things are not moving as fast. Wow, thank you. So generally, I got to ask this question, do we really want this? And you can divide it into questions like, what are we afraid of? And part of that question is, what are we rightly afraid of? And part of it is, what are we unjustly afraid of? Conversely, what are we dreaming of? And sometimes we dream of the right thing, and sometimes we're misguided in our ambitions. And we might also want to think about, what is a good outcome? What should we be aspiring to? So on the flight over here, I actually started watching Westworld, which was, of course, quite useful science fiction for this conference. And really, what it's all about is using the machine as a mirror. And I think this is a very common thing in fiction and science fiction, that you use the robot or the AI as a mirror for us humans. And of course, the core thing here, at least in the first episodes I managed to watch, is that we're really worried that we're not that nice. Westworld is really showing a lot of really dark sides of humanity. And I think part of the fear we sometimes project onto the robot is, of course, that what if a robot turns out like us? And there might also be a fear that what if a robot actually is a moral agent, and we're going to treat it really, really badly. So these are, of course, the core for many, many good science fiction stories. And I think they're also kind of correct fears. We need to be worried about it. I don't think we need to worry too much about the moral value of machines in the next few years. I've written some papers about when I believe we might need to worry about that in neuromorphic systems, but it's relatively far away. But it might creep up on us, and it behooves us to think about that carefully. And trying to be better, obviously we should be doing that. Philosophers have been arguing that for thousands of years without talking about robots. Although it's worth noticing that Aristotle actually, in his Nicomachean Ethics, did one of the first discussions about robots where he notes that wouldn't it be wonderful if we had tools we could talk to? Then they could do all the hard work, and we wouldn't need slaves. But then he continues, well, we don't have such tools, so we need slaves, and then he goes on justifying slavery. Well, so much for his early work in robot ethics. Now, the interesting part here is that the popular imagination of a robot rebellion is, again, very much based on the mirror. We might be rebelling if we're forced to work for others. So the robot rebellion is very much the idea that machines would be like us, and hence they would like to rebel.
But if we get that kind of rebellious machine, you have succeeded amazingly well in your artificial intelligence and can probably make a machine that doesn't want or doesn't need to rebel. There is also this idea about hubris and nemesis. Maybe by creating robots in our own image, we're kind of usurping divine powers and then we should get what's coming to us. Again, a classic literary trope. I think these worries are inaccurate. Because the real problem we might get from machine intelligence is it's very hard to control autonomy. Not because it's wild or that it wants to be free, but that it's very autonomy by its nature is very tricky to influence and control. And we want it that way, otherwise it wouldn't be autonomous. So the actual problem is that we're creating these complex adaptive technological systems, many of which ones are not housed in a single robot, but across entire economies, complicated webs, like those nice graphs we see behind us from the laser scanning. There is no single node, there is a swarm intelligence, and if something goes wrong, we have a systemic risk, and those we're not very good at handling. Anybody who's been programming genetic algorithms or reinforcement learning know that we're very good at finding ways of cheating without understanding what it means to cheat or that it's a bad thing. So we need to find ways of specifying what we want them to do. So what we want to achieve in our machine learning utopia is, of course, to solve tough, useful problems, have systems that recommend things to us that we really want, or maybe even inverse reinforcement learning that watches us and tells us, given what you try to achieve, this is what you want to do. Or might even be deep enough to realize, well, what you truly try to achieve is this, which is different from what you think you're trying to achieve. That would be wonderfully useful if we can listen to it. The idea of an adaptive, robust technology that can make sense of vast data, including our biological data, is really wonderful. And of course, it would make it easier to create. No longer we would have to program, but we would just show, demonstrate, and train, and that would be enough. But the problem here is the system behavior is no longer specified solely by us. It's specified by the data and experience of machines. And that means trouble in paradise. It means that even fairly passive machine learning is in some sense autonomous. And of course, the best task for current machine learning are the ones where we have a lot of data and we know fairly crisply what we try to achieve. Unfortunately, the most important situations in life typically don't have much data and we don't quite know what we try to achieve. So here, current modes of machine learning are not going to be helpful. So one of the big problems is validating these systems is going to be tough. And it's going to be hard to pull the plug because we're going to be black boxes and distributed systems embedded in a lot of other things. So this means that the misbehaviors are going to be really interesting. After all, when you work in machine learning, one of the biggest delights is figuring out why did it do that? The problem is, of course, when you use something in the field, you don't want to have that fault. So we have problems where we have a wrong kind of emergence, whether that is Amazon trading bots and outbidding each other, creating a book sold for $6 million. It was a used textbook on how to handle personal bankruptcy. And you certainly would end up there if you try to buy that. You can get weird cases of emergent deception. We developed a little toy model where we had a robot, a reinforcement learning agent working in a warehouse, and it was supposed to put one box into a chute in a corner. That was what it was rewarded for. There was a surveillance camera watching that and turning off the robot after doing its task. But by chance, of course, the robots occasionally discover that if you put a box in front of a surveillance camera, it can now put a lot of boxes down the chute. It might have been a stupid engineering solution, but it's a good example of how you get a system that doesn't have a theory of mind, yet starts to deceive the human. Because if the rewards or punishment signals are coming from humans, then the system will start trying things to manipulate humans. Even if it's not smart enough to even understand what the heck a human is, it will just try things and notice that sometimes the rewards get better. And whether that is because they accidentally jammed the foreman into his office and he can't shut them off, well, the machine doesn't care. And this, of course, leads to the interesting question, how do we make them care in a useful way? How do we achieve value alignment? And this is tricky, because philosophers have been working for 2,500 years on what is human, what is true human values, what is good. And I'm sad to say, even though I've been asking around at the Oxford Philosophy Department, we don't have an answer really yet ready. In fact, there have been a fair bit of progress, but it's mostly about digging deeper rather than getting some nice ready-made thing. You can tell the programmer in the specification, plug this in and the robot is going to be a great moral agent. In fact, I think philosophers are learning more now about ethics by getting engaged with this community that are actually building agents that are starting to encroach on the morally significant roles. So the problem here might be that in order to get safe and beneficial in artificial intelligence, regardless of whether you have an intelligence explosion making them super intelligent, or whether it's just garden variety autonomous cars, we need a way of specifying human values, what we want. The problem is we're bad at specifying it. Philosophers and poets have been trying it for a long time. And observing humans is also a computationally tricky task. Yet we need to find ways of digging up this information in a useful way. Either because we want it from a commercial standpoint. After all, the butler robot that actually serves you well is going to be much more valuable than the butler robot that just wrecks your apartment. And the autonomous car that figures out what little Miss Brown in her little car is actually trying to do in the roundabout is going to be much safer for Mrs. Brown and its passengers and everybody else than the one that just assumes that everybody else drives like autonomous cars. So we need to solve some of these problems. So when we want to integrate robots in our lives, we have interesting challenges. We can, of course, try to enhance ourselves so we're smarter than the robots and can figure out and debug them on the fly. But I think most people don't want that. Most people, for some weird reason, don't want to have an engineering degree in order to use a personal computer. I don't know why, but people really complain about it. Instead, they want something that works straight out of the box. Now, one interesting thing is, of course, that the whole point of technology is to do magic. We want to cause change according to will, as the magician Alistair Crowley said. And technology, when it works well, is magic. Things just happen as we wish. The problem with most fairy tales is, of course, that, yeah, be careful what you wish for. Most fairy tales have a bit of danger of that. And typically, of course, the fairy tale forest is a bit of a random place. We have made these stories because they make sense from a human standpoint, which is also a bit of a risk when using fiction to guide our thinking about robots and machines. Because sometimes we do things like deep dreaming. We produce these surreal things that are a bit like what we might come up with, but typically not quite. And if we try to estimate what we might be doing based on what we did in novels written by humans for humans and aimed at having an ending that appealed to humans, we're going to be a bit disappointed. We're going to get a lot of very surprising effects. So what we want to do is probably get the transparency right. We need to be able to figure out what is going to happen. We want also to figure out the balance between enhancement and replacement. So when Google looks out on the parking lot and sees a lot of robots with no software, they're thinking of the autonomous car as a robot. When I talk to some car and vehicle engineers, they want the car to be a cyborg. Or rather, the owner, when he or she sits down in the car, they become a cyborg, Iron Man. They get enhanced by sitting in this wonderful car and have a lovely driving experience. Now, which of these approaches appeals the most to us? And to be honest, I think it depends on us. I don't drive. I'm a very European person. I'm totally fine with sitting in a robot. Others really want to be the Iron Man. Similarly, I get really annoyed when I get asked by a system like Cortana or the infamous Microsoft Paperclip to interact on a social level. I just want my queries and information to come from my extended mind distributed in my computers and gadgets and cloud and enter my head by writing some commands. But I have friends who really prefer to have a social emotional interaction. So we need to be able to fine tune this and do it relatively seamlessly because otherwise we get terribly annoyed. So to conclude, we need to some extent renegotiate the world, both with each other and our institutions, but also with our machines. And part of that core is trust. How do we establish trust? Once upon a time, it might have been enough if a man in white lab coat and a pipe stood up and said, I'm a proper engineer, and this is my robot. It's a good robot. We would have trusted it, because a man in white lab coat said that. That doesn't work anymore. We might want to trust the machine itself. And one way is, of course, lots of experience. We roughly know what we can and cannot expect from any machines. The problem is complex machines might misbehave in very complex ways, and we might never have enough experience. Sometimes, if it's transparent enough, you can actually see what's going on. I was watching an elevator at an airport recently, and I was amazed because it had glass walls, so you could very clearly see all the safety features, which was enormously reassuring to recognize, yep, it was just not one cable it was hanging from, but seven. It was totally obvious to anybody watching that this elevator would need to have a very serious fall before it could fall down. You can construct systems that are transparent about the safeguards, and I think that is going to be quite important when we design our autonomous and learning systems. We need to be able to look into them. And this, of course, goes with the interface systems too. When you have your cyborg soldier, or when you integrate with your smart airplane, it needs to be possible to see the intentions, whether they're machine intentions or human intentions or whatever else. And to conclude, once upon a time, there was an airship named Hindenburg that had an accident, a very tragic accident in front of television cameras. And everybody decided that was horrifying. Oh, the humanity. Let's never make Zeppelins again. That was more or less the end of the era of the great airships. But in 1830, the rocket, Stevenson's early train, was inaugurated, and it promptly ran over a member of parliament. The response was, oh, we better make trains a bit safer. But wonderful, railways, let's build a lot of railways. Why did the Hindenburg end the era of Zeppelins while the rocket opened the era of railways? Well, I think part of it is people saw the use. It was obvious that it was useful to have trains, even though it's stupid to step out in front of them. Zeppelins was an elite project. It was good for a little bit of travel, but most people could never participate. And I think we need to make sure that our new technologies that we're dealing with have a wide applicability, so people get to play around with them, whether that is little home computers and home robots, or applications they can see, and applications they can poke around in to get a sense of what's going on. Because that's the only way you're also going to be able to have a trust in the public, because you're going to need the support of the public for these projects. The discussion about our aspirations requires everybody to trust everybody, or at least then trust each other to have an interesting argument about it. So in the end, I think we want transparent, corrigible, safe, and beneficial systems that are also good at figuring out what we want, because we might need their help to figure out what we should be aspiring to. Thank you.